tears and I say, no, something, tears not going to help. Look, you get strong. You get strong. You will not fail. God has given you spirit of favor, power, love, and a song. You have to be very patient. It may seem impossible sometimes. Why am I waiting? Is there a shortcut to this? But wait. Wait on the Lord. Wait on the Lord.
There's no word that can come back, boy.
Stand firm on the hope of God. Although we are uncertain of what God is doing. As much of a prayer or a soul or Christian you are, sometimes you're uncertain of what God is doing. But we can be certain of his character. He cannot change. He said, yeah, I am. He said, I am the I am that I am. I put my word above my name. And he will not and never bring us to shame. He will never leave us nor forsake us. Hallelujah. He's always acting in love towards us. In Jeremiah 29:11, he says, I know the plans I have for you. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. So when the person is telling you that, look, your situation is hopeless and expecting a water maybe, zoom in to Jeremiah 29:11. But why must we wait? Why must we wait? Why can't we get it like some other people? Some people you see today, they have this, and we tell them a short time. They get something quickly. You went in for years. They said, God, what about me? I'm coming to church. I'm serving you. I love you, God. And then you might put self in front of you. You might put pressure in front of you. You might say, God, look, I think I'm better than that person. I don't fast. I don't drink. I don't do this. But God doesn't understand that. God doesn't work with that. He doesn't look to say, well, okay, you think you're better, and you deserve this. Serve me. Just serve me. Don't look at the other person. And whilst you're waiting, recognize that what you're waiting on is going to surely come to pass. Let's look at the fruit. God wants us to grow fruit in our lives where it takes time to ripe. All right? Patience and perseverance. He wants us to show him more in our lives. He wants to get the glory. He wants to grow our relationship with him. If you recognize on a tree, the last thing to grow on that tree is the fruit. So waiting brings forth the best fruit. Don't get anxious sometimes. Don't get anxious. And recognize this also. Whenever you are waiting, and it seems as if other people are getting ahead, tell yourself, God, I am waiting because my race is a marathon. This might be a sprint. Think about that. When you're waiting, my race is a marathon, God. You're making me wait. Let us look at the prodigal son. The father, if he was not waiting for his son's return, he would have had a dismissal attitude towards him. But when he saw his son coming back, what he said, he became overjoyed. It means that somewhere in the back of his mind, he always had a hope and he's always waiting that my son is going to come back to me. Hallelujah. And that is the reason why he could have run towards him and hugged him and welcomed him back and prepared that feast. This is how God is waiting on some of us who have turned away. But as his word said, he is forever married to the backslider. Jeremiah 3:14 says, turn over the backsliding children, said the Lord, for I am married unto you, and I will take you, one of the city, and two of a family, and I will bring you to Zion. Hallelujah. In Matthew 25, we remember that story of 10 virgins. They were all waiting for the bridegroom's return. Are you prepared as in your mind, your walk with God? And we were hearing pastor recently saying, are you rapture ready? They were all waiting, but some were wise and some were foolish. So even though you're waiting, you have to show wisdom whilst you wait. You have to ensure that you stay in that place of being a light, knowing when to turn off your lamps, when to turn it on, not let it burn right through, because if you're burned out, you cannot serve God if you're burned out, and that is what happened to the five foolish virgins. Their lights were burnt out. They had no more oil and they were burnt out. Think about it. Think about your life. What are you burning out in your life? And that you are not finding time for God. Keep a balance. Keep a balance. Put God first, and He will do the rest. Keep that balance. Hallelujah. You know, we're saying, I'm saying that we should consider ourselves at all times to be pure in God's sight. Let's consider ourselves that we will not. We make an oath to never cuss, drink strong liquor, dislike someone, or those terrible things. But there are some things in our life that's in it that we cannot help, that we are born with the sinful part of man, which Paul said, you kill man every day. Meaning that you have to kill those fleshly thoughts and the fleshly things that comes upon your life. You have to kill that every day. Alright, as you wait on God. Remain steadfast. James 1:2-4. It said, come to all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials, and these will be trials in your life. For you know that the testing of your faith whilst you're waiting produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. Blessed is the man who remains steadfast or perseveres on the trial. For when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those loving. It means waiting. If you're impatient, God can't work with you. God can't work with you if you're impatient. You have to be very patient. It may seem impossible sometimes. Why am I waiting? Isn't there a shortcut to this? But wait. Wait on the Lord. Wait on the Lord. Revelation 2:2-3 says, I know your works, your courage, and your patient endurance. But how you cannot bear with those who are evil, but have tested those who have called themselves apostles and are not, and found them to be false. I know you are enduring patiently and bearing up for my name's sake, and you have not grown away. Whilst you're waiting, be very careful too. There are many persons who are professing that they are called and they are God's people, and you see some crazy things on Facebook in which they do not sort of crazy things, the people telling them to go and eat grass, and the Lord told them this, and you will melt away your mountains like candles. Be very careful whilst you're waiting. Do not be caught up with some of those things. I saw even, and I had to laugh at it because some of them are laughable. This guy, he is washing his feet, and then he's taking the water and rubbing on people's head and their faces and all of that. All these are crazy things. Whilst you're waiting, be alert as to those things. Be alert that there are false ones among us who are trying to do those things, even though it's not in Guyana. I'm not saying, well, okay, there are not some people who are acting that way sometimes in certain areas and doing certain things and telling you, look, you don't need to do this and you don't need to do that, it's not biblical. And if you don't read your Bible, you don't know.
Right.
Hallelujah, you have to know these things. My response to all that is what a gentleman said, a white gentleman. He said, stay calm and carry on with your lives. God will do what He alone knows how to do. He does not need a reminder, nor does He need a wake-up call. His timing is perfect. So perfect. You know there's a saying that hurry always make a bad curry. You have to try to hurry to do something, it doesn't come out good. Doesn't have come out good. Hallelujah. He also say that, you know, have you ever tried to take food that's very hot and you burn them out? And whilst your mom would say, wait a minute, and they have to cool it or have tea sometimes, you know? So even when we want things to happen fast, just keep God. Just keep God uttermost in your mind. Hallelujah. When we wait on God, He knows when and how to promote us. Like in Psalm 275:6. He talks about promotion. And it's not only that promotion on the job. Could be promotion in your church, promotion anywhere. Alright? And God is saying, it does not come from the east nor from the west, but it comes from Him. And why some persons may think that I should have been in His position, I should have been doing that, I think I'm prayed up enough and I should be the worship leader, I should be the best dancer, I should be this or so. And if God say that you are not ready, I have to clean you up. Yes, you're going to be a mighty man or woman, but I have to clean you up. Wait, don't push yourself. Because there are many persons, as Pastor mentioned, would have started churches and things like that, and he fell because God was not in it. Because you push yourself as man first, but you wait on God, and he will clean us up before we hurt ourselves in the long run. Because if we push ourselves to the core, most times we become hurt, because if God is not in it, we become hurt. Hallelujah. If we realize that whatever battle we are fighting, it's not ours, it's the Lord's. God said this, "Listen all Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem and King Jehoshaphat. Thus says the Lord to you, do not fear or be dismayed because of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours but God's." And many times while we're waiting, we think we go through a battle and we alone go through it and there's nobody else on God's earth would have gone through this, but not so. As long as God allow you to go through something, he's strengthening you whilst you're waiting. And he will not allow you to go through something if he knows that you're not strong. But because he knows that we are strong, he allows us to go through things. It may seem harsher for you as for other persons, but go through it. Go through it with prayer, go through it meditating. Alright? Do not give up. When you go through things, you just say, "Thank you, God, that you have chosen me to go through this, God. And you will show me the end of this." Hallelujah. Wait and be of good courage. Wait, I said. Even Jesus, and this is how waiting, it is such a profound word. Wait. In the Garden of Gethsemane, what did he tell his disciples? He said, "Sit down here and wait whilst I go over there and pray." Why? Waiting, talk about waiting. He knew that if they had come along with him, they probably would have interrupted his flow of thoughts and his prayer to his Father while he was interceding. Can you imagine how crazy that would have been? Because he may have had Peter swearing, even though he was, and all of these things going on, and saying, "No, it can never happen. They can't take you away." And Jesus knew that this had to have happened for us to get salvation. It wasn't just for him alone. He was saving a whole world. A whole world. Hallelujah. There would have been others like me crying and holding on to his robe and saying, no, don't pray. We're going to hide. Let us go and hide somewhere until this has passed. But no. Waiting is such a powerful thing. And as we wait on Lord, on our Lord, let us be steadfast. Let us stay calm before we wait. And let us, whilst we're waiting, let us not stop doing the things that we would normally do. Let us not stop blessing persons. Let us not stop doing that. As little as you may have, share. Let us also look at Abraham when he told his servant to wait here. See, there's a lot of waiting in the Bible. It's not cooking there because he couldn't use another word that just wanted that. He told his servant, "Wait here." And wait here also is for some persons who you can't take further with you. From where God is taking you, you have to tell them, "Wait here." You can't take them further. It may seem strange. It might be a family member. It might be one of your children. It might even be a spouse where you might have to say, "Wait here. You cannot come in." Look, even in the Bible, when the little boy had died, and the mother ran, and she found the man of God. And she said, "You know, I went after this child and look what happened, the child died." And when he went there, the child was on the bed which the husband and wife, they had set aside a room for this man of God because he used to pass through this area so often. And what he did, he told them, "Wait outside." He did not allow them to go to the room with him because that miracle of that child coming back to life may not have been. But he told the mother and father, "Wait outside." They could not go outside. Waiting is so powerful. Hallelujah. Even in Acts 1:4, Jesus said, this was said, "And being assembled together with them, Jesus commanded that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith to you, 'Ye have heard of me.' For John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence." Going anywhere or not having the Holy Spirit with them, leave them open to disaster, and Jesus knew this. So he said, "Wait, wait. As you go through life, wait. Do not just go thinking that you can do everything. You wait. Pray to God and wait. And furthermore, I say that the 9th of June is fast approaching. And we know that there is a seed offering to be given. Alright? And let us not tarry too long with that seed offering. Somehow the Lord taught it in my spirit that that seed offering would be very powerful. And this is the reason I mention it now. It came to me this morning about the seed offering and waiting. And whilst we do that, whilst we plan that seed offering before the 9th of June, don't just wait and be back and say, okay, I expect this and it will happen, and okay, Pastor, don't pray. You pray as Pastor said, water your seed. Water your seed. You continue praying. You continue praying about it. Don't just drop your seed and say, okay, there's DNA. He got praying. He's the man of God. You pray to him. You pray to him. Praise God. Lord, I'm in agreement with my pastor over the seed. I'm in agreement. And this, as I said it before, is a powerful seed. A powerful seed to plant. If you can plant more than one, as the Lord will allow, plant more than one. And as you wait, hold on to God's word. Okay? Remember also, when you are thinking about something, and then this is a part of waiting too. When you're thinking about something, you're thinking too hard about it, in your humanness, it doesn't happen. It does not come to pass. But the moment that you don't forget it, but you hand it over to God, then it comes to pass. That is because you can't do anything outside of God. You have to hand it over to God. And then he said, well, okay, I will do it now. And he does that. And he brings it to pass as a surprise or a perfect gift. So when we're thinking, oh gosh, I have to do that, you're not giving God any time to work because you think you can help God. And even though some people know it's not in the Bible, but God helps those who help themselves, it's not really in the Bible. But it means that you have to help by praying. Praying, not trying to help God or forcing the situation. Leave it as it is. And you're relaxing God, you're resting God. Like when David prayed and he asked God for peace because of his neighbors who were tormenting him and all that. And after a while, David, he rested in God. And God did it for him. And that is how we should be. Wait on God. And as I close, can we all say this? Father God, thank you that you are present in my waiting period. Help me to trust that your timing is best, and you will bring to pass all that you have designed for me, and according to what David said in Psalms 27:13. I believe that I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Amen.